The key thing is this, the discovery of a new class of object that now is going to produce a new class of science, and new people will start making their entire careers studying this kind of object.
I had just come back from a big planetary sciences meeting on Sunday the 22nd when Richard Wainscott called me at home and said, "This object, I believe, really is hyperbolic. It's on an orbit that makes it from outside the solar system." You know, that term is a description of the shape of the orbit, effectively. And so that was really exciting. I said, "Wow, we're going to have to get on this immediately."
So I was kind of like maybe the initial person to realize the magnitude of this discovery and sort of get Karen involved to help mobilize the bigger effort. So immediately we saw that it was point-like. We tried to get colors of it with the Canada-France-Hawaii telescope.
Ideally, to get composition, you want to take what's called a spectrum, where you spread out the light into really, really fine intervals. And that can give you something about its chemistry. This object was really too faint to get a spectrum, so we used different colored filters. And it turns out that this object looks particularly red. When an astronomer says it's red, it doesn't mean that it will look like it's glowing red. It just means that at the red end of the spectrum, it reflects more light than at the blue end. But we think this thing is very dark, so this just means it slightly reflects more at the red end, but it's going to be very dark. So it would probably look blackish.
Then at the end of the conference, I got an email saying, "We can't see your object, and something's wrong." So then I kind of ran back to the hotel lobby and got onto the Wi-Fi. We're looking at a photograph, basically a digital photo. So the camera is a big camera on the telescope, and I was downloading just one part of the image, the part that should have had the object, and got very worried because I couldn't see the object. And then I still couldn't see the object. But then eventually I just saw it, just saw this little faint dot. And then it got a little brighter, and then it got a little brighter, and then it got really bright. So, but I was really worried we were pointing in the wrong place because we couldn't see it. And of course, what we were seeing is that the object had an enormously strong variation in brightness because it has to be very elongated in shape.
There's approximately 20,000 objects for which we have what we call a light curve. Of the 20,000 for which we have light curves, only a handful have light curves that give you an axis ratio as big as 6 or 7 to 1. But there's nothing at 10 to 1 in our solar system.
I think things like this discovery makes us much more visible to the world, that's for sure. And pan-STARRS in particular, I think it is the biggest discovery by pan-STARRS by far. It's not really exactly what we funded for. We funded for finding dangerous asteroids that might hit the Earth. So this is a byproduct of that work. It's a very exciting byproduct of that work. But you have to remember that what we're doing is planetary defense. But if you want to take it to an extreme, these kind of things can hit the Earth. They're probably more rare than asteroids. And I think if one of these were to hit the Earth and leave a meteorite behind, then the meteorite would not have the same age as the solar system.
By looking at what got ejected from other solar systems, we may understand that the process of how you build a solar system is similar everywhere or different. And so I think it will help us understand how we got our habitable solar system.
I suspect we've missed these and that we have some in the bank. I'm hoping that I can go back and find one or two more. I don't know, no guarantees, but I know how to find them in the future, or at least I hope I know how to find them in the future.
It's been a lot of work. I mean, to get all this pulled off, we had approximately 9 days from the time we realized what it was until we submitted the paper to Nature. 17-hour work days with no breaks whatsoever, and the whole team had to pull this kind of effort. And that was the entire window in which this was bright enough to really do meaningful science on it.
The world of astronomy is pretty competitive, so especially on this object, there are a lot of people eventually sort of trying to understand it, trying to observe it. It's our discovery. We want to be the ones that understand it ahead of other people.
For me, this was a real eye-opener. Everybody was keen to be the first person to report on some aspect of the object. But part of the point of peer review is to make sure it's robust, there aren't mistakes, it's thorough.
I think it's probably the biggest discovery in astronomy in the last, probably since the discovery of the first Kuiper Belt object, which was also done by UH. So certainly the biggest discovery in solar system astronomy since then. In my opinion, although a little bit biased, maybe on par with some of the gravitational wave work as well, but other people would argue that's more important. The key thing is this: it's the discovery of a new class of object that now is going to produce a new class of science, and new people will start making their entire careers studying this kind of object.
What really excited me is the fact that we had a piece from another solar system visit us. And for however brief, we got a chance to look at something from elsewhere. And I think it would be neat to be able, for the next one, to have a space mission so that we could be ready to visit it up close and personal.